Hi, in this video I'm going to demonstrate how to use an array to count the number of letters in a text file. The text file I'm going to read is Robert Frost's The Road Not Taken. Classic poem, you probably read it in high school. If you haven't, take the time to read it, it's really good. So I'm going to count the number T's, number H's, number E's, etc. What I'm going to need to do is I'm going to need to open the file in C++, read the file line by line, and then walk through the line and count the characters. So I'm going to count on T's, H's, E's, etc. I'm going to play some games with ASCII on this. ASCII, we might recall, was the American Standard Code for Information Interchange. And I'm going to use those as my array index positions. All right, so let's set some stuff up. I've got my some prototype functions I'm going to end up writing, but I need some variables. Now, when you're working with big arrays, it's usually done that you put them up here globally or in the class section, depending on what you call it. That way you don't have to pass them around. You only have to create them once. It makes the program run a little faster and use less RAM. All right, so I'm going to start with that. Now, right now, as you know, in C++, nothing is initialized for this, so I'm going to have to set this and initialize that particular value. So let's clear that out. I can do that right here in main. Now, you probably know where I came up with 26 number of letters. There are 26 letters in the alphabet. So all I'm doing here is I'm zeroing out the array. Very important in C++ to do that, not so important in other languages. But C++ will hold random gibberish here, and I start to count with random gibberish in there, I get random gibberish back. So I'm going to now display this. So I'm going to create show counts, I'm going to call show counts here. And show counts will display my number of letters. I could type. Alright, so I'm going to walk through the letters and display the numbers on the screen. Now I'm going to do a really cool trick. Alright, so I'm going to use a for loop, because you always use a for loop to walk through an array. It's just given. It's like those word association games. If I say array, you say for loop. If I say cat, you say dog. But I'm going to walk through using the letters. Let's see what this does. You probably can guess what it does, but it's going to display the alphabet. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I get it. The reason this works is most programming languages will allow you to iterate over anything that's iterable, which means it's sequential. So chars are iterable. The reason they're iterable is because they're just integers. They have a value, though. If you look up the ASCII value, so the ASCII value of A is 65, the ASCII value of B is 66, etc., all the way down to 91 for Z. Now we can use that to become a loop control variable. So let's put here. Subtracting off 65. That's going to put A at 0, B at 1, C at 2, etc. Quick run in this. I get a bunch of zeros. Now let's take a moment and let it make it look pretty. I'm going to use some additional manipulators here. I'm going to make this a 10 character wide column, set it to the left. And then for my numbers, just give me a ton of space between my the words, the letters, and the numbers. Yeah. Left does what it says. It left the lines in the character in the column. Right writes the lines in the columns. And there are essentially 16 characters between here. So I now have decent outputs. Let's do some math. So what I have to do is I have to open the file and read the file. My function parse file is going to do a lot of work. I'm going to call parse file right here. I'm going to pass in the name of the file I wish to open. So it should do this correct, so let's do it right. Now, by creating a variable for my file name, I could easily ask for the file name. So my parse file function is going to take a variable of type string, which just shows up there, and it's going to open it. And traditional file manipulation here. Open it, check to make sure that it opens. If it doesn't, die. If it does, walk through it, do something, and close it. Okay, so I'm going to read this thing line by line. So I'm going to read the road not taken. Then I'm going to parse the line character by character. Then I'll read Robert Frost. Then I'll parse the line character by character. I could read this file character by character, but I just want to show you how to read line by line. So open the file. I'm going to do this differently than I have in the past. In the past, I've done if not EOF. I like fin.fail. It's clearer. If the fin fails, die. And then I'm going to use exit to kick out. If I just use return, it sends me back to show counts. I don't know that I want that. I just want to die. And again, one is an error code. So let's make sure I get my counts still. It doesn't die me. It does. Good. It's purposely misspelled Frost. Make sure the kick out works. Good. All right. So again, we're clean. I forgot to close my file. So I've opened the file. I've verified the file opens, and I've closed it. I'm now going to do something with the file. And here I'm going to do it differently than I have in the past. I'm going to use Getline to get one line at a time. And it's a pretty cool trick. As long as Getline gets something, it returns a true. As soon as Getline fails to return something, it returns a false. Getline will die after line 25 because there's no more lines to read. As long as there is a line in the file, Getline will read it, regardless of how big this file is. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to count my letters. I'm going to create another function to count my letters here. Now, I could do it right here inside the while. But the more you break your code up into smaller functions, the better off you are. Because you can comment stuff out, you can easily adjust things, and it becomes a lot easier to read. Instead of 50 lines of code inside of a while, you have one line of code inside of a while, and then a function call. Now, there is a performance hit on that. It does take longer to open up a function than it is just to run it iteratively or inside, but as learning the program, it's better to write it like this. And I'm going to comment the end of my functions here because we're starting to get a lot of them. Always a good idea. 30 seconds worth of commenting saves you an hour and a half of scrolling. Alright, so count letters takes a string line. And I need to walk through each line. I'm going to walk through each line one line at a character time. Now, since each one of these is a different length, I can't do a simple for loop. I can just have to deal with a variable for loop. This is L, not 1. Length is one of those features or methods on functions of strings. If that doesn't drop, make sure you pound include a string. Every now and then I see just length does not work if you don't have that pound include string. Okay, so I'm going to count the letters, but I have uppercase and lowercase letters to deal with. I'm going to make my life simple and convert everything to uppercase. So inside of here, I'm going to create a new variable. I'm going to call the function toUpper, which does what you expect. It converts something to an uppercase. So that's let equal toUpper of line dot at parenthesis 1. This is a way to pull out a character from a particular part of the line. There are other ways to do it, but I like using at here so you can see another method. So again, this is a string method, returns the char at a particular location. toUpper converts to uppercase, and I store that in let. And then A is 65, Z is 90. So I want to make sure that they're between those particular ranges. So I'm going to check with an if statement to make sure that I'm getting the correct values of A to Z. I'm not going to worry about counting colons and commas and things like that. So this is just ensuring that I'm looking at characters. If you're not sure I'm getting these numbers, visit ASCIItables.com. You can also visit, unicode.org, but that's a much bigger site. ASCIItables.com will give you an ASCII table, and you'll see in the third column that capital A starts at 65. That's its decimal value. And B is 66, C is 67, etc. Z is 90. So as long as the value that I read out of the file is between 65 and 90, I'm going to count it. And now here's where I'm going to get really slick. Since I'm using an array of size 26, A is at 0. You could do this. Etc. And if I do a quick run on this, make sure I didn't do anything stupid, A and B work. Right? Who wants to write 24 if-else-if statements? Me either. So I'm going to get really slick here. Remember how I subtract let minus 65 here? That 65 minus 65 is 0. 66 minus 65 is 1. I'm going to use that same math up here. I'm going to get rid of that. That is not bad code. That is just long, tedious code. So I'm going to say let minus 65 plus plus. That does my counting for the entire alphabet. A is in position 0, B is in position 1, C is in position 2, D is in position 3, etc. Rather than having 26 variables to track 26 counts, I use an array, manufacture some type of positioning, and then count. If you wanted to, you could build an enum on this and put that enum inside that array and come up with a really clever way to count. But this is a really slick, common way to do counting, is have an array to hold all your counts because they're related, and then massage the index. Let's see what we get. Let's see, 9Fs, a bunch of them, which, who has one? Q, there's one Q here, let's prove that. That didn't work. There's a Q, there's one of them. Is there a Z? No Z. What else we got in outputs? Y. 11 results. Look at that. My math works. 18 W's. Woohoo! So we've counted Frost. Let's have fun. Let's count Dracula. Yes, this is the entire text of Dracula. Later today, when someone asks you, what did you do in class today? I want you to say, we read Dracula. Because you would not be wrong. So I put Dracula in my file name instead of Frost. And I'm going to modify this so I get a better output. Oops. I hit the wrong button. Helps to spell file name. Letter counts in Dracula. 52,667 A's. 9,026 B's. Only 836 J's. Every letter is represented. And again, as we did before, we could go prove that. Clearly, it's trivial to do a C out C and ask for the file you want to read. Alright, so we use an array to count the number of letters. This logic could very easily count, you know, lines, words, whatever you want. Take a look at, you know, your ASCII value, see what the value is for space, and if it's a space, just count it. Every time you reach a new line, lines plus plus. So it wouldn't be hard to modify this. But what you want to get out of this is this trick of using an array as a counter. That's your biggest deal here. Also, zeroing out your count array, very important. All right, that's it, guys. Thanks and good luck.